a special planning and zoning commission meeting for the purpose of listening to the public. So let me introduce you here, members of the planning and zoning commission. We have John Corbo, member. Del Nashay, member. Karen Miller, alternate. Brad Hookta, alternate. Nancy Hel Sheehy, member and chair. Alex Hutchinson, vice chair. We have Hiram Peck, town planner, and Nina Frazier, zoning. All right, so having introduced folks, we have a presentation in the papers for this evening. And then in terms of the agenda, the agenda will begin tonight with a brief presentation from Hiram Peck regarding appropriate economic development, some ideas, thoughts, and samples in similar towns. And then we'll open up for public comment. One thing that I just want to reiterate that's important, there is nothing in front of the commission right now. We are not aware of anyone looking to develop large pieces of land in town. This is simply a listening meeting.
Can you hear me okay? Please use it. Just speak without the mic, is that all right?
Why don't you project your voice, please?
Thank you.
People will not get, can't hear it.
How about that? Is that better? So the chairman said, my name is Hiram Peck, and I'm planning consultant, been working with the town for a few years. And this particular issue came up a while ago when the commission was getting a lot of applications. It started off with storage facilities, actually. And the commission said, you know, do we really want to see as many storage facilities as there are in town going application after application? And not that that's a bad thing, but they asked the question, they said, is that what we want us continue to see, especially on Henry Road, but in other places in town as well? And so then the idea came, well, what do we really want to see in the future? And I think the commission is being extremely open-minded about this, and we want to make sure that you understand that. As Chairman said, there are no applications pending now that are of huge significance. But what we wanted to understand was, can you go to the first slide? We want to get the public's input with regard to what Bethany's future is going to look like, what it could look like. And this commission has a lot of authority with regard to applications that come in, applications that get approved, some of which you may think are great, some of which you may think are not so great. And so we want to get your opinion about that as we go forward. And I can explain to you a little bit more as we go forward about what that's all about. First slide shows a little bit, a couple of examples about what some other small towns in Milton look like. Some of these are in Connecticut, some of them are in other states, but they basically represent small, relatively rural towns. Most of them are bigger than Bethany, but what they intend to show are what the design looks like for each of the centers that are in there. And so next slide, please. Next slide, I'm going to talk about what the future is for Bethany. What are the issues that people want to talk about? What are the specific things that need to be discussed and how best to get public input? So everybody thought that the first thing we need to do is talk to the public, obviously, get your input about things that are important, specifically with regard to land use, economic development, specifically preservation and conservation. Appropriate housing in the future will be important as well. And then what are the constraints that we have going forward? Next slide, please. Talk about these things. The plan of conservation and development was done a while ago, and sometime in the near future, it's probably going to be due for an update. It has to be updated every 10 years, according to the state, anyway. But it can be updated before that, certainly if the commission finds situations have changed, or certain things have changed. The plan of conservation and development is a big regulation, a big document, rather, that serves as a backbone for zoning regulations. Of course, nothing would happen if the municipal budget didn't allow them to happen, at least typically from a municipal standpoint, that's the case. And then there are various site and area specific plans that the town has, and then also a developer could come in with. So there are a number of different things that could happen to move things forward. Next slide, please. So where is Bethany's village center? Is there a historic center? Is there an economic center? A lot of people think that they know where it is, but we want to hear from you. What do you think it is? Where do you think it is? Where could the economic center be? What are the benefits of having a village center? There are some economic benefits. There are certainly some aesthetic considerations and some cultural considerations. And what are the drawbacks of an effort to create a more viable village center? Some of the drawbacks that people might say is, well, we really don't want a lot of growth. We're a small town, you know, 5,000 or 6,000 people. We want to stay that way. We don't want to change. But there are a lot of reasons to at least consider whether you should change or not going in certain directions. Next slide, please. There's a couple of small town examples here. And what these examples show are, again, small towns, some very small towns. But what they show is that some development can take place if it's well designed and well located and well situated in the lot. It necessarily, it might attract some development, other development in town, and things that are appropriate, of course, in terms of size and the infrastructure that the town has. So these, again, are just some examples. And again, some are in Connecticut and some are not. Next slide, please. How do we create a village center, even if we wanted to have one? How do we retain the rural character of Bethany? Obviously, rural character is a significant starting point. We want to maintain the rural character. But how do we do that? There needs to be some sort of broad planning effort that considers public input, as we talked about before, and education for creating a public vision. A lot of times people have an idea and they think that's a great idea. Other people hear things and they say, that's a terrible idea, why would you want to do that here? So we need to get everybody sort of on the same page. This is just the beginning of the process to try to get things at least discussed with the public to find out where we go forward. What are the possible future land uses that are both we do want to see, and what are the things that we want to exclude? There's some economic opportunities and constraints as well, and what tools are available for that? And what are the concerns about that? This presentation, as I said, is going to be fairly short. I just want to make sure that you understood that I do know that there's obviously local things that people are very concerned with. This happens to show a horse barn with solar panels on it. So some may have that, some may not. But something to consider in the future. So consideration of the local flavor is obviously very important as well. Well, what tools should we use? Aside from the public discussion, which tools should we use to gather the needed data? We need the public input, as I mentioned. But we need to do a little bit more closer look at current economics. Next slide. The village market analysis and maybe a fiscal impact analysis. There are going to be certain things that people may come in and say, well, this is going to be great for the town because it's going to generate a lot of tax dollars. Well, maybe that's true, and maybe that's a good idea. Maybe it doesn't generate the amount of tax dollars that we necessarily want to see in a particular site. There's one thing that happens when land is developed, and that is it's used up for at least a period of time. Whether it's a building that's built or some other use, whether it's conservation or whatever, that building is taking, that particular property is taken care of for a period of time. So we need to figure out what are the things that we want to see along 44, Amy Road, for example, or anywhere else in town. Next slide talks about known barriers. There are physical constraints to the property. There are wetlands, there are water courses, there are steep slopes, sometimes there's rock. Sometimes there's not a lot of infrastructure. We'll talk about infrastructure, I'm sure, a little bit later on this evening. But there are policies and regulation hurdles too. There's traffic, there's economic issues. And what incentives can we offer to people? How can we get people that we want to come to town to do things? What are available from all the federal, state, and local sources? What are those? If we did want to create a village center, we talked about that a little bit, but we'll talk about it a little bit more, I'm sure. Next slide. What are the general principles that are desirable for a village center? The first thing that I think is really, really important is it the design of the town is really critical. But somebody can build something that might be fine in Center Hartford, might be great in Bridgeport, might look okay in Naugatuck, but it wouldn't necessarily look in place here. So I think the design of whatever people bring in is really important as well. The design should be sustainable, that is, it should take care of people, places, and it should also allow whoever's doing it to make a profit or make it feasible to go forward. There needs to be some limitations with regard to the size and the location of the particular development. There needs to be traffic limitations. Nobody wants to see traffic jams, unnecessarily traffic jams. Well-considered building design and signage is critical. Next slide, please. May sound like a little bit of a broken record, but I'm absolutely convinced that good design is the key to moving forward. Some really nice designs here in some very small towns. These happen to be, one's a residence, one's a small store, one's an inn. Those are things that could fit somewhere located properly and appropriately in town if people wanted to see that. What needs to be the regulatory framework? We need to have some zoning regulations that allow us to do what we want to do. They need to be clear. It wasn't too long ago that zoning regulations were done, but there's always potential for changing them and making them more sensitive to what people want to see. There's some things called overlay zones which could be created. There are design regulations, design standards, and there are things where you can actually create small residential developments for people that maybe don't want to take care of a large house anymore. Maybe they want to move to a smaller house. And those are cottage developments. They can be cottage developments. One thing we could specifically plan for in zoning regulations are creating lots for smaller homes where folks that have lived in town for a long time and want to get away from a large house, maintenance of a large house, paying for a large house, but they want to have a smaller house. And so those are kinds of things we could take a look at in the future too if people decide that's something that we need. There need to be density limitations based upon the design, and we could update the plan of conservation and development. How do we best achieve these things? We need to make sure that the small town desirability and the convenience is there. We need to make sure that these designs are sustainable. But the architecture, again, is at a special place. We want to make sure that Bethany remains Bethany. Along with a cooperative approach and the desired development, will make things easier. When people come to a commission, whether it's the Wetlands Commission or the Zoning Commission or the Zoning Board of Appeals, there needs to be some way to determine whether you're going to get a permit without spending a tremendous amount of money and then finding out you can't do it. So we want to make the permitting process easy if the projects are good projects. And we want to get continuous public input and periodic feedback as well. And then the last slide shows a village center which is more dense than Bethany would probably want, but this again is a small village in Connecticut that shows that good architecture can fit along main streets. It can fit in and do well with regard to accommodating some economic development. And the last thing I have to say is we're here this evening to hear your comments, your thoughts, what you think about that, and like to move forward. So that's it now, Jim. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Hiram. Lena, I didn't make mention, but we do have a letter from the Economic Development Corporation Commission. So I'll just make note that that has been received. We'll open it up for public comment. Like I said, this is just a reminder. We're really only here to listen. There's nothing in front of the commission. This is our attempt to be proactive should anything come before the commission, but also, as Hiram mentioned, we do zoning and we do planning and we update our documents as well. So the whole purpose of tonight is just to get a feel for what the town is looking for in terms of economic development. So with that said, is it easiest, Lena, if people want to speak? The microphone's available there. And
maybe it's not really crossing across to the to the height, so.
What do you recommend?
Probably come closer to, towards the aisle, actually, and not really, people for the public can hear us.
Okay, and I think just state your name and address, right? That's what's required, okay.
I'm Sharon Huxley, 340 Old Mill Road. Would you please actually read the letter from the Economic Development Commission so that we all know what it says?
I can actually share it as well.
It's three pages, Sharon, you want a copy?
I can actually share it. I can actually share it.
Everyone what was in it? I mean, I'm on the Economic Development Commission, and I don't know what's in it.
Okay. So this is the letter to the Planning and Zoning Commission and to all Bethany residents. The Town of Bethany Economic Development Commission believes that our town's economic future is dependent upon thoughtful and considerate growth and development. Change of any sort always carries an element of unknown. The members of your EDC believe that small-scale growth, effective, impactful, tasteful improvements scaled appropriately to our cherished small town can be implemented without adversely impacting the image and feel of the community that we all enjoy. Below are several key areas that the EDC is advising be investigated and implemented. Public utility improvement. Our town currently has no municipal water system. There are businesses that choose not to establish here because of this one factor alone. By introducing a water main to the already industrialized portion of Route 63, certain businesses that depend upon a consistent and reliable water supply, in parentheses, bakery, coffee shop, restaurant, microbrewery, light manufacturing, industry, etc., will be able to consider Bethany as an option. Federal funding is available for rural communities with populations under 10,000 through USDA, U.S. Department of Agriculture grant programming. By introducing a limited basis partial water system, our town's ISO, in parentheses, Insurance Services Office rating, will subsequently improve, allowing for lowered insurance costs to potential businesses, thus making Bethany a more attractive option. A limited basis partial water system along Route 63 will also afford our fire department more options and ability to provide fire protection as needed along our town's most industrialized corridor, as well as the numerous neighborhoods that directly access that portion of Route 63. A concern we have heard is that once water is introduced to Bethany, growth will be unstoppable. The EDC asserts that thoughtful, carefully curated growth can be managed effectively by not simultaneously introducing a municipal sewer system, as is common, and continuing to rely upon septic system design to limit property growth and density. Municipal infrastructure improvement. Our town currently lacks any physical means of connectivity from one business to another along Route 63. By installing sidewalks and appropriate lighting along a limited portion of Route 63, we can ensure the safety and convenience that our town residents and visitors, patrons deserve. Our neighboring town Prospect installed sidewalks along the developed portion of Route 69, effectively connecting the entirety of that business corridor to its public parks, churches, and town center. In the fall, they host a festival that extends along the entirety of this improvement. This was done almost entirely with grant funding. The portion of Route 63 that the EDC envisions initially being serviced by this improvement would begin in the area of Lock, Stock, and Barrel and extend southward to CFC Park, thus linking many of our town's most popular and frequently patronized businesses to our athletic fields, the airport property, our public safety complex, and any future town center. Future expansion could include extension to the library, churches, and historical society, offering improved safety and community continuity for events such as parades. Existing recreational facility improvements. The BAA athletic fields have seen limited physical improvement in the past 40 years. Bethany is centered amidst seven directly adjoining towns, as well as an additional 11 cities and towns abutting those communities. By adding lighting and other physical improvements, the BAA could increase the use and availability of our town's ball fields, extending playing times and seasons, thereby creating opportunities for teams and drawing patrons to the businesses that surround the BAA property. Our town's public course arena is one of only a few such facilities in the state. Our town has one of the highest, if not the highest, course per capita ratios in the state. Given Bethany's status as the only community in all of New Haven County designated as rural, the EDC believes it is vital to capitalize on our town's unique designation, central location, and long-standing course history to become a destination for equine-centric events that could inject much-needed income to both the town as well as patronage to the surrounding businesses. A proactive plan. Bethany has a unique asset in our former airport property. It is historic. It is vast. It is accessible. It is central. It is the functional part of our community. It is our unofficial town center. It is the thoughtful use of this parcel that the EDC believes needs to be very thoughtfully, thoroughly and thoughtfully examined as a means of forwarding our community, all the while being mindful of the multitude of groups and people that use this property for so many unique activities and town events. Large tract open spaces need to be protected and preserved. However, the periphery of this space offers several possibilities for the small-scale infill growth that could enhance our community and provide the establishments, services, and spaces that a future Bethany will most undoubtedly need in place to support our ability to remain the vibrant, charming town we all cherish. State mandates. The State of Connecticut General Statute 830G clearly defines the requirements all communities are mandated to implement regarding affordable housing. Bethany continues to be non-compliant with these mandates. As multiple communities throughout the state are being embroiled in lawsuits and forced change, it is the opinion of the EDC that Bethany would be best served by taking a proactive approach to what will undoubtedly become required housing development and having a community-supported plan in place prior to being ordered to do so by the state. Governance considerations. The EDC suggests that the town consider employing a full-time grant writing professional. The EDC suggests that consideration be given to separate planning and zoning, and that economic development and planning be formed into a cooperative entity tasked with planned growth and development as a whole for our community. Consequences of maintaining status quo. It is the EDC's contention that if the business non-residential component of our town's grant list does not sufficiently expand, the cost of basic services and town governance will continue to outpace residential property tax collection, and that the financial burden will continue to negatively impact our residents. Respectfully submitted, Stephen Winter, Chairman, Town of Bethany, EDC.
Susan Bradford, you bring my name to the room. Some, like all good suggestions, have you sat down with them and talked about how to move that forward? Or were you looking for feedback from the public first? Or were you looking for other ideas?
This is an open forum. We're listening, so it's really trying to hear. The objective is to hear what the town is interested in terms of economic development or no economic development. Look at everything Hiram said, locations, everything that was in the letter, and we have spoken with the EDC. They've been at our meetings. So, like I said, I don't think I can overemphasize listening. There's nothing in front of us, nothing up for debate. It's really just listening to what people are concerned about with regard to economic development, what they'd like to see, not see.
Well, it makes sense that, you know, to build, you know, some type of faux town center around the airport, because that's, you know, it attracts the most people, especially with the CFC, is that what? That new organization and facility right down the street. So that tying that together, but you know, that little shopping center that you can't even see from Amity Road is disadvantaged because you know, it needs some kind of rehab in one way, shape, or form. Because you have a place for businesses, but the businesses don't seem to survive there. And is it because they don't have the infrastructure, or is it because they're not visible to the street? I don't know. But that seems to make sense to try to build some economic activity around that attraction, because those facilities can be used for a variety of different events, including the equestrian.
So I'm cross between what it is that we're mandating. Oh, I'm sorry, down Shine 1100. I'm confused about what things we're mandated to do that we really have to do according to the state mandates. And then what is it that we're trying to do as a community? Are we trying to look nicer? Are we trying to pull more people in, more businesses in, and we're trying to expand? I mean, I think that's what I'm trying to figure out. Like, I mean, I love it here, so I'm fine. but I try and figure out, what is this push? Is it because we want to have build our economic stance in town? Is this going to help us economically? Is it going to help us look nicer as a town? So those are the kind of things going through my head that I'm just putting out there. In terms of some of these pictures that we saw, those are communities that were, my guess is that there was a little green and there was a little church historically, and there was, you know, general store, and they kind of built up that way. Bethany, was it? It was kind of like you had your little churches over here, and then you had your farms, and, you know, it was sort of spread out, and, you know, because people had their space. So we don't really have that. I mean, do we need to create that? The closest I come to thinking about is the airport. To me, is a beautiful space. We can do so much in that area, and we use it a lot in different events for sports and all kinds of stuff. But I agree with the Superette area. The thing is, it's an eyesore. I mean, I think if we did anything to kind of reevaluate that whole area all the way up through with the Stuffer Barrel place all the way down through the gas station, and we thought that area where it was like just a really nice place where there was a, you know, a circle of stores or something, or I mean, that would look nicer as a town, I guess. And in terms of the water supply, I never thought of that as a problem for you know, people who have the businesses here. But if that's what we need, to have more business come in for economic reasons. So those are all the kind of small thoughts in my head. I don't know, but I mean, I'm happy where I am. I'm trying to figure out why we have to do this. I would love to see the Superette look better than it is. I think it's, like I said, it's a little old. And that whole area, if you go back in the back, all the way to the front, that length, that's a lot of space. But outside of that, I don't know. I mean, if the mandates are something else, you know, we might as well get ahead of that, whatever that is. Those are my thoughts.
So I'd like to address your question about the mandates.
Yeah.
The 830G is not a mandate that you have to have affordable housing. 830G sets a floor that the town does not have at least 10% of its housing stock that meets the definition of affordable. I'll come back to what that means. Developers can come in, and as long as they propose developments where essentially a third of the housing stock they want to put in, it meets the affordable housing criteria, they can proceed essentially without public hearing or planning and zoning, as long as they comply with all of the zoning requirements and meet public safety and fire code requirements. But it wouldn't be an open public hearing where people could say, if a developer wanted 20 units in, they could essentially require us And then for anybody who's been around for when Rocky Corner, Greenhaven, that whole development first got proposed, that was proposed and actually proceeded under this 820G provision.
So there's a requirement to have affordable housing, and we've never addressed that.
It does not require it. They cannot mandate the town has affordable housing. I'll kind of defer to our town planner. But the 830G provision essentially allows developers to come in and propose developments that, as long as they meet the affordable housing criteria, they get to be able to proceed with that. So we wouldn't have oversight over design and how it would look and how it would fit within the character of the town. They could come in and just say, this is what we want to do, we meet the requirements. So Hiram, I will also allow you to weigh in.
Sure. The town was required by the state a couple of years ago to prepare an affordable housing plan, and we did that. Mm-hmm. There was a deadline, I think it was June 22, that we had to do that. And so we did that, and we're in the process now, Alex is in the process now, finding out whether we can put together a committee or group of people to talk about how we should move that plan forward in a way that fits Bethany, not something that's going to be really large and dense and out of place. So we're trying to figure that out now.
Okay.
So there is a plan, and he's absolutely right with regard to the mandate thing. You know, all due respect to economic development, it's not really a mandate. It's just that the developer has the right to a quick appeal. If the town doesn't approve something, if he comes in under 8-30G. And so we want to avoid that. A couple of things that the town has going for it with regard to 8-30G. One is, we don't have an extensive water system. And in order to have a lot of density, you need water and you probably need sewer, or at least you need an area big enough for a large septic field. So there's probably not going to be a huge rush for a lot of affordable development. What we would like to do, though, is find out what people want to see in terms of, are there smaller houses that would be appropriate? Are there smaller lots? Are there things that people would want to see? As the community ages, there are a lot of folks in town that are aging in place that would maybe not necessarily like to keep the large house that they have now, but would like to stay in town. And finally, I would say this, that what we would like to try to do is find out, how do we make it more convenient for you all to live here? To go to the store rather than drive to Naugatuck or drive to New Haven or wherever, drive to Luke. How do we make it more convenient for you to stay here and still keep it as rural and as attractive as it is now? So those are things that are really important to us.
So just one more comment on the mandates. We are required, every town is required to update their plan of conservation development every 10 years. So we're probably, another 5 years away from. But we also have to update our housing plan every 5 years. So we're about a year and a half away from having to update that. So those are two mandated requirements. But again, I do want to emphasize, we are not mandated because we have to go in and put in affordable housing. It simply means if we don't meet that threshold, developers have a lot more leeway in being able to proceed with the developments they want to bring in.
So we're talking housing, but we're also talking village.
We're talking both.
Okay.
From our perspective, one of the reasons we want to have feedback about a village center concept or some sort of a commercial center is the possibility that there may be mixed residential with retail. When we did the affordable housing plan about 3 years ago, I don't know if you all remember, we sent out a survey to the residents of the town with a whole bunch of questions about what you'd like to see, what affordable housing means to you, how important it is. One of the overwhelming responses we got back, I mean, this was hands down, at least 2/3 of the responses, desire to have an alternative for people who've grown up in Bethany, who now are seniors, who really don't have the ability to maintain their current property. They would love to stay in town, but there's no smaller place for them to move to that's easier for maintenance. So all of this does factor in at some point together. So the housing and economic development kind of go hand in hand. Businesses are not going to want to come here if we aren't a growing community. We may have the businesses that we need right now. That's part of what we want to get feedback on. But if we want to be a vibrant, not explosive growth community, what would that look like?
Monty Radcliffe, Old Hill Road. It would have been, and this is for future reference, it would have been extremely helpful to me if I had a copy of the letter that you read that included a lot of, you know, considerations, suggestions, or whatever, from which to conceptualize any questions I may have, any suggestions, in order to frankly foster, appropriate and helpful public discussion and form of discussion. Because I didn't really consider any of the things that were mentioned, sewer, infrastructure, that type of thing. So for future reference, I think it would be a really good idea to distribute those kinds of things before a meeting like this, so at least we know what we're talking about.
In defense, I would just say, you just got it, you know.
Right.
And so the other thing is, too, this is the first kind of first meeting, so no decisions are going to make.
No, nice.
Feel free to get a copy of
it. I understand, but it's nice to know what we're talking about.
I just got it in my email today as well. So.
Sharon Huxley again. I applaud all of the efforts to create this kind of ambiance in the town and create some kind of a more viable commercial base because we need the money. we just desperately need to be able to honestly shift some of the tax burden onto commercial properties. However, I'm very disappointed not to have heard yet anything about looking in other parts of the town, because it's first of all, the east side of 63, like where the Superette was, where the shopping center you're talking about. Part of its growth problem is not just water. It also doesn't have a septic system and can't increase its septic system. So bringing in water is not going to help. And that's a problem with several of the parcels on that side of the road. You're not. But the other thing is, we're talking about potential infill development. If you go through that area of 63, the only place to fill is the airport itself. Is to move onto that property and lose. I know you've heard this from me before, but I think we should keep our mitts off it until such time as we've created another space somewhere else that can absorb all of those events and the utility that space provides for our town, because it is a community center that everybody, at least half the people in town around that airport, at least once a week doing something. And to lose that is to lose the soul of Bethany, because right now that is the soul of Bethany. That's where it is. That's where it happens. And there was something else. People keep talking about equine events. We still have horse rooms. We have rings. Fine. People, private individuals, use them. Trust me. There's not enough room anymore for to attract any large equine events, because there's not enough room anymore, because Much of that land has already been purchased for playing fields, so you don't want horses on playing fields. It's there for the tag sales. It's about a third of it is now used for municipal purposes up on the north. And by taking all of those spaces, if you were to try to hold any kind of large equine event, the kind that would genuinely bring a lot of economic growth to the town. You can't do it in that space unless you take away all the other uses that are there on the open piece. It's too late.
Sharon, could I ask you this? And I certainly understand what you're saying. And I guess what we need to hear, not necessarily tonight, but are there other places in town that could be developed appropriately for even a larger equestrian facility? I happen to be familiar with a town that just sold a golf course, 230 acres, to people that own the Farmington Polo Club. That's a really a larger facility, and what will happen there, I don't know. But I mean, are there other places that could be developed for larger equestrian facilities that you think would be better for them, or not? I don't know if you can answer it.
We have a large number of equestrian facilities, but they're all semi-private. They're boarding and show facilities, but they can't handle the kinds of things that we used to be able to do at the airport, and the kinds of things that would attract a large number of people. Because you want spectators, and you want competitors, and you want services, and there just isn't room there anymore to do that. So I'm not saying tear them down, but I'm just saying it's not realistic to say that this is going to be a source of economic growth.
I did just want to follow up on your comment about everybody focused on the airport.
Yeah.
And again, Hiram helped me with history here, but this has been an ongoing, Sharon, you've been on planning zoning, so this is not a new topic of discussion. But there were three different areas of the town that have been identified for potential commercial development. One is the airport area. The second is the southern part of 63, so think Teddy B's, Grand Pizza, that whole area down there. Third, I believe, is up around 69 and 42.
Right, possibly.
Okay. So, there has been a lot of focus on the airport, but there are other options that have been looked at, could be explored more fully. So I just want to make sure we put that out there.
One of my concerns is that gradually over the years, what has happened is that infill has removed most of the options on both of those roads. Because if you drive down 63, where do you have a place that you can build any kind of commercial facility? And you have a similar thing going on 69, where it's a lot of it's waterboarding. I don't think they want commercial development on their land. And you have to look somewhere else. That's all. All I'm saying is find space somewhere else and create
what you want. There are lots of things that are being done too with regard to water supply, not just the water line, but there's lots of things. Septics and the way septics are designed, there's a whole series of very high-tech things that are coming along as well. So when you talk about infill development, it doesn't necessarily have to be some huge structure. Look at that recording studio building. How big is that? Small building. Great, nice building. So there's lots of infill that can be done if it's appropriately sized and fits in well. It can be small. But anyway, just to fit.
Brian Axer, 11 Terry Drive. I want to say what's happening on water effects, what's needed for businesses is look at where the water lines are coming in from. And if you want to have a small limited water supply areas and lines, what area of town gets you there quick? Because putting down that water to get to the town center that you have be immense cost to get there.
Carol Lane, 567 Guarantee Road. I would like to see that airport hangar rehabilitated. I understand the roof leaks, but that to me is a really nice big building. Often, I'm the president of the Land Trust, and we try to schedule meetings, but either the lodge is not available or. And there's not a lot of places for big meetings, and I think that'd be a wonderful thing for additional social activities, community activities, and it's just kind of sitting there right now. So, I mean, I think there's probably some way to get a grant that would address making that sort of community to do that.
So, 101 Kildare Road. I am a retired architect, and I was Yale's planning director for about 20 years. And I had some thoughts that I had written, and I see that a lot of the ideas that I had already had been addressed either by the planner or the committee, but allow me to rhythm, so it's just a confirmation of some of the good ideas that I heard here. So there are two primary issues that I see definitely. I've been here 5 years. To visually improve the public perception of Bethany as a unique town with a distinct townscape and provide spaces for services to increase community engagement. I usually live downtown Manhattan and I drove up 63 many times, but until I moved here, actually I had no idea where Bethany was. There was no town image that I could identify or I could say, oh, this is a nice town and I should come back and explore it. What can we do with 63? So as people kind of move through it, develop an image of what Bethany could really be a nice New England small rural town. So some of the areas that I've been thinking is, for me, the historic district I define as the area where it starts with Petrol, where the old firehouses, and it kind of ends at Falls Road. It has two historic churches, it has the library, it has the historical society, it has some beautifully kept homes. Well, that's something to kind of start and start interconnecting. But trying to walk between those surfaces on Route 63 is a harrowing experience. I mean, usually we need a policeman and the library has an art event to kind of help us to go from the library to the Veterans Society. So sidewalks, I think it's a very important item that we should begin thinking about interconnecting all the spaces so you can walk from point A to point B. Actually, Bethany Land Trust has a preserve across the street from the library, and nobody knows that it's there because we're all kind of driving through it. Well, we can make a nice entrance, and that can become like almost a town park. I think the old fire station is one of the few distinct architectural buildings that we have. And I think it should be used more than what it is right now. I think the services that are there, valid as they are, they probably don't get to be in such a prominent position. I think the building with a few modifications, like change with glass or the roller shutter doors and put some canopies, and it becomes a very nice building to bring in developer. It can be sold, it can be rented, it can become an income producing thing. Will be a great place for a destination restaurant. Other towns have destination restaurants. I mean, you know, we was the town where our left side is. So, Banta. I mean, people come from all over because, you know, because it's a good place to eat. It can be an antique shop. It can be a
movie theater. A movie theater.
Well, that's a little too small for that. Second is on Route 63, we should not allow more aluminum boxes. And I think we should have a design review committee, so anything that 163 has to be approved. And what we can do right now, and they're probably prancing there through Main Street, beautiful certification, whatever, landscaping. We should make it, well, maybe we can have force, maybe we can help a lot of the businesses to improve the landscaping, so Route 63 becomes a much nicer road to drive through. And the third is the airport site for commercial development. You already mentioned the hangar. I mean, I know a lot of people have said, boy, wouldn't it be nice to have the music events, you know, every Saturday or Sunday or Friday. It could be jazz, or it could be folk, it could be the whole spectrum. I mean, we get people in town that really want to do that. And it's unfortunate that we're not using it. I mean, we tried to use it for protecting the land trust. I tried to get it. And I got comments like, well, you know, you can use it. Well, how much does it take to put bedrooms and fix the lips, you know? It's a beautiful structure. And most of the people that I know that have come in here, for them, that space, their mind, as the icon. And I think the field around will be a perfect place to do a commercial development. I agree with you that we should look at horse barns as an icon of what it can be unique to Bethany. And that's what we're looking at. I think it's important in order to make it economically viable to include your offices and to have housing, so make it a little mixed use services. Again, cafe, we need a restaurant, we need a sit down restaurant, we need a cafe where younger people can come and open up their laptops and go there and let it go. Talk with other people who are part of the young people who are like cafes and they don't have an option in here anymore. I'm not sounding angry, I'm and I think we should, you know, allow for the flea market to occur. I think if we develop, maybe it can become a year-round, maybe the airport on Saturdays become a flea market. But it can be, you know, all year long, a place where local farmers can do, we can have a farmer's market in there. Anyway. Those are some of my ideas that I knew they were mentioned, but like, I want to get out of my system. Thank you.
Yes, I used to be in the Elizabeth Appellman, 11th Church Drive. Yeah, the village concept where you change the frontages of everything so it looks nice and quaint. The problem with the economy right now is there's a lot of vacancies everywhere, and they're not going to come running to Bethany. That's just a fact. We do have an infrastructure problem, of course. We don't have water or sewer. Now, I'm curious, though, what is the status of the old property that's sitting there? Just sitting there, is it used for any purposes? It's non-profit. How many acres do we have?
I've only been there once, and I really don't know if there's anything on it. I'll bring this in close.
What
part
was it?
The Yale property. The southern end of town.
Somebody owns it, but they've got a horse facility out of the arena. That's what I'm doing. It's off of Old Andy Road in the back, adjacent to the Yale
property.
That was sold. Yale's not on it. But it was the light up there. It was incidental to a fire problem on the day.
You know where they're going to bring stuff in the game and dump it? What was that?
Oh, okay.
That's what I'm talking about. That property back there, is that still there?
Yes, nothing. It's
nothing. All right, well, it's just property just sitting there. We could start thinking about putting solar appropriate places in town. That's what a lot of towns do that have agriculture. But I believe that planning this is a good discussion to talk about what needs to be done. A lot of people are against sidewalks because the liability that's involved in that. It was a really big thing years ago, though. The state would pay for it. Okay, the state would pay for making your frontages nice and, you know, looking. And we almost had money for that. That was for the state program. Instead, we used it for the airport hangar. That was the year the state said, all the towns would do it. Most of them did. They did not do that.
So if this discussion's good, then kind of planning aside, I think though that the country as a whole is in a big state of change. Don't you see it where retailers are going under and stuff like that? It's a very different environment than it was, say, 5 years ago or 10 years ago. Economic development is very different. And a little town like Bethany, we need to keep our taxes low, but we have Latitude, right? We have one major business in town, Latitude. Okay? So what would happen if that? Can we attract businesses here?
I'm not so sure.
All we can do is make it as nice as it can be to keep the people here who want to live here and our town center, maybe a few small places, shops and such. But I don't think we're looking at attracting industry here or any similar big business. Just ain't gonna happen. They're not coming to Connecticut, period.
I would say just one little thing is that towns have a certain attitude that they project to developers, and sometimes are planned and ready to move forward certain projects and are welcoming to certain development. And I think that's the kind of an attitude that you want to attract development that you want. I think that's very helpful. There are other towns that are not that way and that end up in court and spend all your money in court. We don't want to do that. So I think that having this discussion is really, really important. There are a lot of good things that you bring up. No question that retail is really tough right now. Every time you go on your computer and order something from Amazon, you're killing a local business. You know that. I tell my wife the same thing all the time. So what we would like, I suggest anyway, if you want businesses, it's going to be the kind of thing, small businesses, where people need to go in and get a cup of coffee or buy something themselves. It can't be the kind of thing where you can just order it online and get sent to your door by FedEx or whatever. So we have to think through that stuff and to where we go, I think, is what the commission is trying to do right now, figure that out.
And just to follow up on the comment about whether or not we will or won't have any new business development. In the last 10 years, organically, Locks, Lock & Barrel, CFC, the football club, the Shell station, that was with no plan, and I'm not making any judgment whether it's good or bad. What we're trying to figure out is if there is a vision, and we're not talking about 1 or 2 years, we're talking about 10,
that's
20,
right. That's
30
right.
Years,
that's right.
For what we might want that to look like.
Mm-hmm.
And so whatever comes out of this process, and to your point, Sharon, about everything is infilled. For example, that area was designated as that's our long-term vision for a village center. That storage facility across from CFC. Economically, it may make no sense for that owner to continue to do it as a storage bit. And a developer could come in and say, we could do this, we could do that. If we have a vision, it allows developers to start looking at us in a certain way and maybe bring to us concepts or ideas we hadn't even thought about. So that's part of what I hope we can get out of this dialogue.
In the back, we'll go around. I think a huge issue is already in a town center that I've been touching the airport is the eyesore across from the airport. That plaza that's individually condo owned. Addressed. I don't know if it's how it could be addressed, who approved individual units, who owns, I heard, the majority of the units. Maybe a developer needs to come in there and offer him something. How do we get somebody in to solely take over that plaza? Like, that's really, like someone mentioned, like the soul of Bethany is the airport in America. That's like gotta go. That's gotta be redeveloped. That is a huge starting point. As far as it could really be utilized for something great, whether it's a total tear down, whether we offer some kind of incentive to somebody to come in, like those individual just not cutting it, and businesses aren't surviving, they're out on the pasture. Let's be realistic, like the only happy place in that plaza, Bronco's like trying to make it, they have a great steak and cheese, not a pizza, but I mean,
realize that their deck could have been changed up to make it much more of a village concept. And you can decide as a town that anybody in that particular area has to follow a certain way. Your signage, and this thing. It may be quaint and fun. It would cost lots of money, but it can change the character of the town. So, let's take a few steps.
Yeah, just one quick kind of thought to add. The CFC complex brings a lot of people in. If you can have some sidewalks from there to the local ice cream shop, you know, so that they can walk from there to something else, that would attract maybe some local sandwich shops. Okay, so just really bringing people in, giving them the ability to walk from there to something else while they're there.
Sharon, do you have a thoughts?
Yeah, on a slightly different subject about trying to create a streetscape. It's been over 40 years, because I've been in Bethany 40 years, but when I was living in Cheshire, the Planning and Zoning Commission there commissioned a study for a streetscape beautification plan. And what came out of it was what you see on South Main Street and Main Street in Cheshire. They got grants, they picked sterile bread repair so that they didn't drop fruit and make them, you know, a problem. But they gave them away to any businesses that wanted them, but they asked them to standardize the distance of them from the curb and where appropriate to have sidewalks. But they don't actually have sidewalks on all of Route 10. And you look at that now, 40 years later, it took about 20 years for it to happen because it wasn't mandatory. It was voluntary to start, but any new development was expected to, because they changed the standards for curves and the distances and what the plantings would be. What they created was something that's absolutely beautiful year round, because among other things, it's creating this whole sense of unity, because you see this unbroken, now 2 mile long strip that all has uniformity and it pulls everything together. And something like that is something that could be written into the regulations, that there are actually are grants available out there for streetscapes, make it possible for people to adopt these changes. It would be really nice to do it without requesting the town anything. But, you know, Cheshire could afford it and did. But it's something seriously to think about that has less impact than asking for architectural changes. But I don't know, I think it was 30 years ago here, we recommended an architectural review board to our board of selectmen and they didn't adopt it. But what we were looking for then was just, I don't know, what were we hoping for? Just some common sense uniformity again, and scalability and design along Amity Road, because we were really hoping not to, no offense to anybody who lives in Naugatuck or anybody who lives over in the valley, but we were trying to move on, not I'm not sure we were hugely successful, so we're trying to get that. And that's something we can do.
25 years ago, I don't know how many people you have in downtown Manhattan, but it was not a great place to visit. And I'm moving there. And the town, the city decided that they have to do something with the downtown, and they developed the town green district committee, and I was one of its commissioners. And the idea was clean and safe, but also economic development. So one of the things that the city did is establish a facade plan program. So any owner, if they wanted to fix a facade, the city would pay 50% of the cost. So if, like you're saying, somebody can do something with a shopping center without tearing it down, but you can do something with the facade to make it better. And then the other thing that the city decided is eating and food was a draw for people. And now you can, 25 years later, New Haven is a food town. But it didn't happen that way. It became for planning that when people came downtown, they had to see clean, they had to see no graffiti, which we don't have a problem in here, but they had beautiful historic structures that they were upgraded. So the town could develop some kind of beautification program that can help owners if they're willing to go maybe 50-50 on it.
So I think the last thing businesses want to hear is you want to shift your tax base over to that.
Stay your name.
That doesn't attract business.
You need your name.
Joe Chartola, 333 Benton. So shifting the tax burden over to businesses, you ain't going to attract no money. You need to tax it paid. You need to give them a chance to get started. You need to not charge them taxes. You need to give them a chance to develop and build, not steal from them right away. That's a part.
Just to address that, we actually have a tax abatement plan for up to the first 5 years that a business is in town.
So that's a good help. The other thing is mixed use. Mixed use helps the businesses because you're already giving them a customer base. What you got to do is get the people to stay, not leave. So if you have people living in the area, you have a mixed use because people can't afford big houses, can't afford big land, people are looking for smaller places to live. You create a mixed use area and you create a community and people visit those people. Instead of people leaving, they come to see those people. They come to eat in the restaurants with their family who lives there. To try to get a destination restaurant, not going to happen. But put a mixed community around a restaurant, now they're not leaving. So I think that's important to build a community, not just look for businesses to leave communities to come here to go, to start.
Show me still 2020 drive. I'm sitting with a certain break off tonight and my mind is blown. I don't understand why the airport property, quote me if I'm wrong, 130 something acres we have up there. That is the hub of the town. Why are we even thinking about touching that? That is the largest place of use of our taxpayers in the town. To me, that is off the table. I don't think we need a village district. We probably know the 63 Plaza. If anyone has to notice, ask the business owners. CFC brings in hundreds of people over a weekend. They're not going anywhere. The village just goes. Steve is hanging on. I hate to tell you this, reality is Steve from New York and Massachusetts are tailgating. It's a very expensive proposition for them to come from the sports. It's a great facility, I think it's great for town, brings a lot of people in, but at the end of the day, they're not spending their money in town. If we look at the 63 Plaza, we talk about the facade, we talk about the facility, does anyone realize that's a $2 million renovation? When the businesses 90% of the time are vacant, they're getting beat. I know someone has a space in there. These people are not even staying long enough to pay their rent. They're beating them for thousands of dollars a year in unpaid rent in the space because the town is bad. Our town's people work out of our town. They're swinging by, picking up what they need, and they're coming home. We are not going to survive in a coffee shop. We are not going to survive these things in the town. The airport property should be left as it is. Where I'm calling, you guys are just have blinders on us. Why the heck aren't we looking at the latitude border? We already have infrastructure there. We have large buildings. Why aren't we looking down there as our developer? It looks terrible. And we're worried about putting coffee shops in? In a center that can't support what's there now? You guys are way off base from what you're looking for. We're talking about misuse. Our largest tax problem in this town is education. Our school system is up 50 kids this year. If we put it in mixed use, we put it in apartments, who's going to educate these kids? And is the $15,000 for paying the taxes offset their one kid? The answer is no, it does not. What have we gained? I think you guys need to sit back and look at the Latitude Corridor. That is your target area to fix. You talk about storage buildings, talk about all this. Great. Do you ever think of what it costs to come and have that building? Don't use the ambulance. Don't use the fire department. It doesn't use school buses, and it doesn't educate the kids that they don't have. If we do that in a reasonable expectation, why the hell don't we do it? I don't understand. They don't use town services. And we don't need our education budget as well, because it's looks like it's going off the charts this year. When you people realize it. I just think your vision is way off in left field. I understand we don't, this town was never designed to have a village district. If the people that built this town 100 years ago thought about it, it'd be a great idea, our hub would be together, wouldn't it? It's 3,500 feet from the town hall for the churches. When you guys realize it, it's that. Why the hell aren't we looking at doing something right there? Leave the airport property alone. You guys need to rethink where you're going because you are totally way off base.
Are there any questions online that you're aware of?
Why does everybody feel like the town's failing? It's on the road. What's failing? People saw it on the street, homeless, what's failing? What do we need anything? Because your tax is going up a little bit? I don't know. What's failing? What's wrong with this town? I believe people like living here. Is everybody leaving? Do we have 100 houses for sale? I don't actually see anything. I think this is a waste of time. I don't think we need development. I don't think we get people to sell their properties. I think if people come in, they come in. If they buy the property, they got a great idea, great idea. I don't think this town is fair.
Anything online?
No, there are no questions. No questions. No. They have been having a hard time conscious here. Someone speaking?
No, Martha.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. Sorry.
We can hear you now. Just unmute your name.
Hi, my name is Cynthia Magiola, 184 Miller Road, Bethany. And I just wanted to comment. I agreed with another planning and zone member who was speaking tonight about the idea that economic development may often happen hand in hand with an increase in housing. Things I'd like to see in Bethany would be things like, I did say I would love to see a bakery in town with maybe more specialty breads than what you would find at local commercial Stop and Shops, but also something that was be a coffee shop, not a commercial one, but not a Dunkin' Donuts, not a Starbucks, but a locally owned coffee shop and a restaurant. Or bistro that aligns with our rural character, where you would have the equine community feeling comfortable. And in my mind, I'm from Fairfield County, and I'm thinking of a place like the Reading Roadhouse, someplace where you can get a lovely steak or seafood dinner, and it has a nice maybe music room in the back on weekend nights. Maybe that's too big for this community, but someplace where you can get a lovely steak and maybe a glass of wine. I think of the Quarry Walk in Oxford, which might be more conducive to local businesses mixed with housing, like on the second floor. Although I do prefer a old New England look, like in East Lyme and places where you have these lovely storefronts, which I would imagine could accommodate housing on the second floor, for example. But Quarry Walk has this, I don't know their water situation, but they have lovely laid stone pavers and cobblestone and businesses mixed with restaurants, doctor's offices. And I thought it was a thoughtful design while trying to purposefully and intentionally have not just a nice look, but preserve a rural look. But you see people coming out and they're hanging out in the summer. They're gathering, having ice cream together outside, places for people to walk among the shops there with a sort of a sidewalk off the road. It's well lit. And I'd love these things in Bethany. I'm not sure the place of it, but these are things that I think could be part of the conversation. I just wanted to say for housing, I've been to the affordable housing tours, and just to quickly try to share with you what I learned was that the Guilford Great Hill Cottage community has a gorgeous cottage style. They're small, like 1,500 square feet, single family units that I think could accommodate small septic systems. Again, I'm not sure that the airport would be the right place for that, but they are housed sustainably by Planet Green Company. And I know there was a waiting list, and I know there were affordable housing. Surprise, there's affordable housing in Guilford, but there is. And the Milford and Wallingford affordable communities are sort of secret affordable housing communities in that everyone, most people pay regular fair market value rent, and a portion of them, I don't remember, maybe 10% or maybe it was 15, qualify to be affordable housing pay participants, but no one knows who they are to respect their privacy. So a small portion of them are affordable housing, but all the units are gorgeous compared to the surrounding community. You would never know that there was any affordable housing there. But I do believe from the tour that I went on that the Milford one was definitely, I believe that had city water and septic. So I learned that a housing that's 830G friendly can be places where you may not have thought of having residences before, but can become more friendly for that. But I think you would need really thoughtful designs to have business mixed with housing and keep it aligned with Bethany's rural character, but I believe it's very possible to do. Thank you.
Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Yeah, I don't see anybody else.
No one else online who wants to say anything?
No, there's
no other comments from anyone else in attendance here in the room? If not, then I think we could.
I believe everybody signed off on this sheet.
Right, and if everybody signed, I think we could close the meeting. Okay, right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.